That radio chick Cheryl Lee here. Welcome to the Still Rocking It podcast, where we'll have music, news reviews and interviews with some of our favourite Australian musicians and artists. Today we speak to founding member of rockabilly band The Living End. Formed in 1994 with his schoolmate Scott Owen, we chat to Chris Cheney. He taught himself how to play guitar age six by listening to Akadaka tapes over and over and practicing what he heard. He has played with the supergroup The Rights. He has played with Sarah McLeod and Green Day. Been on Rock Quiz performing with Divinyl's lead singer Chrissy Amphlett. And again, performing with US rocker Susie Quattro. What has Chris Cheney and The Living End been up to lately? Let's find out. To catch up on podcasts from other favourite artists, simply go to thatradiochick.com.au. You're with Cheryl Lee, That Radio Chick, and I'd like to welcome into the Zoom room today, Christopher John Cheney. Welcome, Chris. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. I'm upwardly mobile. I've managed to turn my camera around the correct way, and we're all good to go.
Well done. We have the technology. We've got some exciting news to share about the 25th anniversary of your self-titled debut album with The Living End. But if you don't mind, can we go back a little bit before we go forward?
Sure.
Well, I think it's common knowledge that you picked up a guitar pretty early and taught yourself. Is music in your DNA? Are you from a musical family, Chris?
The answer is yes, I am from a musical family, but funnily enough, my parents had both played piano when they were kids. They did lessons and they did exams and the whole bit, I think right up until maybe high school, and then they gave it away. So I never grew up with musical parents as such. They were when they were kids. Their parents had also played, you know, in big bands and all that sort of thing, and quite a lot of my extended family. But I didn't necessarily grow up around these people. So it's a sort of double-edged answer, really. Yes, music is in my family, but I'm pretty much the only one who's sort of taken it and done something with it. But mum and dad were big music fans, and there was always a lot of music being played in the house and a lot of diverse and a wide variety of albums. So I do credit them, and I credit mum for giving me guitar lessons in the first place, for signing me up.
So do you have any musical siblings?
Got an older sister, and no, she never learned a musical instrument. She was a big fan of, you know, music in general, and always had, you know, it was Boy George, Duran Duran, Uncanny X-Men, Australian Crawl. You know, that was what was blaring out of her bedroom when I was, you know, when I was sort of 10, I suppose, and she was 14 at that point. She was really getting into music, and my ears were just kind of turning towards that, probably away from football. So I credit her as well. You know, she played a lot of different styles of music, and it was, you know, this is 1985, I suppose. So it was a great time in Australian music and music in general. So there was so much great stuff coming out at that point. And I found that I was absorbing it all, which I think I realized later on when I started writing songs, that I had quite a knack, and I would always sort of lean towards these pop hook kind of melodies, you know. And I think that goes back to being a child of the early 80s.
I also credit your dad. Parenting 101, six years old, was it, when he took you to a Kiss concert?
It's always been misconstrued that I grew up in Wheelers Hill, as did Scott. We both grew up on the same road, which was Gels Road. Now, the end of Gels Road is VFL Park, which is where the famous concert was held. That was 1980. So I was five. So was Scott. Neither of us went. But the thing about that concert was I think it holds the record as one of the loudest concerts in history or something. Them and The Who, I believe, were like the loudest bands in the world at that point. So the whole neighborhood, anyone who didn't go to the concert basically sat out on their balconies or on their front step.
And got a free concert.
And you could hear it. I don't have any memories of that. I kind of have a faint memory of the night. Whether I even did that or whether I feel like I did because everyone used to talk about it, I was probably in bed.
Fast asleep.
Had I been another couple of years older, I definitely would have been there, I suppose. But when you're five, you're still a little bit too young.
Oh, well, it must have gone into your psyche, I reckon. Plus, never let the truth get in the way of a good story.
Yeah, well, I mean, it was a legendary gig. it was something that was spoken about. You know, people are still talking about it now. And then I do remember getting to a certain age where you used to go to the milk bar before primary school and, you know, they had the footy cards and they had the kiss cards. And I collected them both. I had an amazing collection of kiss cards. I don't know whatever happened to them.
You are listening to Still Rocking It, the podcast with Cheryl Lee.
Well, we'll have a quick song, and of course it has to be a Kiss song. How about Rock and Roll All Night from their greatest hits album? And then we're back to speak to Chris Cheney, Australian rock musician, record producer and studio owner. Oh, and founding mainstay guitarist, songwriter and lead vocalist of The Living End. And Scott Owen, you guys met, as you said, at primary school. So you've been friends for a very long time.
Yeah.
Any arguments, any disagreements in that time, or have you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Of course. I mean, you cannot play in a rock and roll band for, well, I mean, let's say it's 30 years, really. We started playing music together when I think we were like 15, I suppose, about 1991 or something, maybe. You know, and it was just that thing of kind of picking up guitars and playing it in the little music room that we had at high school, a few different drummers along the way. And then you finish school and we started doing gigs on the weekend. We got signed. We've now done like 9 records. We've toured the world. So there's been a few moments along the way, I can tell you, but we're brothers. So that's the way it is. And I'm really thankful that we're still doing it. And we're all closer than ever now, probably. You know, I mean, we've got kids that are older than what we were when we first met. You know, it's so strange. You know, I mean, we're also like, you know, we look back at our old photos of when we first met in primary school and our parents look so young. That's the crazy part, you know, and it's a whole lifetime now and a generation and our families are very close. And it's been an amazing journey for them to see these two little kids who initially started out kicking the footy together in a backyard formed this rock and roll band that is still going today.
Yeah, amazing. That's what I was going to ask. Footy. Who do you barrack for in the footy?
I'd go for Essendon. I don't really follow it like I used to. As a kid, I was a huge Bombers fan. It was a religion where I grew up. You had to play footy. And then I got to a point where I think I just got a bit sick of it. Was oversaturation, you know, and then you pick up the guitar and you hear a Chuck Berry record. And that was kind of it for me. I was like, no, football was being pushed to the side.
So music is obviously your real passion. I'm a Richmond supporter, so you and I can't be friends, but
no,
that's okay.
Still Rocking It podcast with that radio chick, Cheryl Lee.
Time for a song. How about Prisoner of Society, the single from 1997, the first of many top 20 hits on the ARIA singles charts for The Living End. Also, track number one on their self-titled debut album. Back to speak to lead singer Chris Cheney after this.
We don't need no one to tell us what to do. I guess we're on our own and there's nothing you can do. So we don't need no one like you to tell us what to do.
Let's talk about that first album. One thing I thought was really interesting, we'll get into the music side in a minute, but the cover art based on a World War One photograph of an all-female bomb factory. Where did the idea for that come?
From the beginning, really, we always did our own artworks. Scott and I, as well as music, we both did drama together at school and we both did art classes. We were always into drawing and into designs and logos and even discovering music. We always liked the bands that looked the coolest as well as sounded the coolest. So the visual side of it was always very important to us. You know, we'd recorded that album and then when it came time to do the artwork, we naturally wanted to do it ourselves. And a friend of ours, a guy called John O'Donnell, who works with Chisel now, but he signed Silverchair and worked at Murmur, a bit of a legend of the industry, was a friend of ours at that point. And he sent us that photograph, this black and white picture entitled, you know, Women Workers in a Bomb Factory. And I think he might have even said, you know, here's a great idea for your cover art. And we just looked at it and went, that's brilliant. It kind of has this abstract feel. You don't exactly know what you're looking at first.
Yeah.
but we put it up on the computer screen. And everything we did back then was, maybe it's a Bombers thing, I'm not sure, but everything we did was red and black. So we immediately put that kind of wash over it, thought that's a killer photograph. We just thought it fit in with the music, of the explosive nature of our music, and we wanted it to be a striking kind of image, and it just seemed to fit the music. And I had designed that logo, the Living End logo, a couple of years before, which we'd been using. And yeah, and it's funny, you know, like a lot of people now are like, God, it's such an iconic looking cover and stuff. But you're not thinking that at the time. You're just thinking, yeah, this fits
this
the message.
Cool.
That looks cool. Looks kind of, it just looked like a great image, a standalone kind of image. And then if you want to dive into what the actual photograph is of, you know, that kind of ties in with that too. The nature of the music was kind of, we wanted it to jump out of the speakers like a bomb going off.
You are listening to Still Rocking It, the podcast with Cheryl Lee.
Time for another song. How about their second top 20 ARIA single? Also, track number 7 from the debut album, hit single from 1999, All Torn Down. And then we're back to find out from Chris, why rockabilly?
All torn down.
Where did your interest in rockabilly come from?
Well, when I started playing guitar, I was kind of like every other guy in the neighborhood. It was Eddie Van Halen, Richie Sambora, Bon Jovi, Angus Young. You know, I was into those types of players, the generic kind of rock players. And then at some point, you know, I don't remember exactly what the turning point was, but I guess I must have just seen Elvis or something on TV, and I saw that Mum had a couple of his records. So I started listening to the first Elvis record, which was out on RCA, not his son stuff, it was the RCA record. It just changed me. From that moment on, I was into this 1950s things. She also had Buddy Holly records, Chuck Berry, Jerry Lee Lewis, the Elvis stuff, Fats Domino. They had a lot of Beatles. So immediately I went, you know what? I'm done with all the contemporary stuff that everyone at school's listening to. I'm going headfirst into this 1950s kind of thing. So got my hair cut like Elvis, started wearing those sorts of clothes, like 1950s sort of clothes. I was obsessed with it. So the natural progression from that, if you're a guitar player, is listening to people like Scotty Moore and Chet Atkins, you know, those finger-picking kind of players. And then I don't know where I heard the Stray Cats for the first time. But the natural progression, if you're into that sort of style of guitar playing, is to listen to Brian Setzer. When I saw them, the whole thing just took on a whole nother level, you know, because they were a modern band playing music with that sort of influence, with these tattoos, and kind of played fast and tough. They looked like kind of bikers. So for me, I was like, this is the coolest thing I'd ever seen. And then that pretty much was like, okay, I'm going to start a band and it's going to be just like that.
And lucky Scott was on board, yeah?
Yeah, he was.
Or did
he
have to twist his arm?
A little bit, yeah. He was getting piano lessons at that point. I was playing guitar already and he was getting piano lessons when we were both about 12, 13 or something years old. So our first couple of little jams that we had were him on the piano and me on the guitar, probably just trying to play through a few Jerry Lee Lewis or Everly Brothers things, really traditional things. And then, yeah, after I discovered the whole rockabilly thing, the Stray Cats albums, is when I showed him and said, man, this is what we got to do. You know, you got to get a double bass. And he sort of remember him looking at the album cover, and there was one of an album cover that his parents had of Bill Haley and the Comets. The bass player was standing right up on top of the bass in this picture. And that just blew our minds, you know. So he went out and got one. He went out like the next week and bought it. And he called me on the phone and said, I bought a bass. Come around and have a look. I couldn't believe it. I turned up at his house and he was already just standing there playing it. He taught himself how to just by watching other videos and things. So he was just a natural. It was an amazing thing. It was just like it was meant to be.
It was meant to be, I reckon. And now that's his signature move, isn't it? Standing up there on the bass.
Oh, you have to. I mean, that's the thing. If you're playing a double bass in a rock band, you have to, you know, you have to spin it. You have to stand on it. You got to throw it around. And I mean, our friends in high school used to look at us like, what the hell are you guys on, man? We were just such fish out of water because everyone else was into like, was either Metallica or Nirvana at that point. And here we were playing That'll Be the Day by Buddy Holly and the Crickets and spinning the bass.
I love that.
we're definitely the outcasts.
Still Rocking It podcast with that radio chick, Cheryl Lee. On that note, I think we best play some Buddy Holly. Here he is with Peggy Sue, and then we're back to speak to Christopher John Cheney of The Living End straight after this.
Peggy Sue, Peggy Sue, pretty, 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 Peggy Sue, my old Peggy, my Peggy Sue.
I love that. And then all those years later, because Stray Cats were definitely, as you said, a pretty big influence on you. And then you got to play with your idols. They say never meet your idols, but how did that work out?
Well, luckily it's worked out great. You know, it's almost like you can call them friends. I was actually just messaging Slim Jim, the drummer, before, because we did a record with Jimmy Barnes last year called Barnstormers. And so we were just talking about, man, when are we going to do some shows together? You know, we were getting close at Blues Fest a couple of years ago, but it didn't quite come off. But the answer to your question is, it's still surreal to me. We met them basically because we got signed to Warner Brothers in America, and our first record came out over there. It was quite a big deal. You know, Prisoner of Society was a bit of a hit over there. So all of a sudden, these guys saw us on the TV and went, look at these guys. They're just like us when we were 21. And so we went over there and they were coming to the shows to see us. That's how we met them. And so that was just the craziest kind of full circle moment for Scott and I, having learnt their records in his bedroom, playing along to their records, learning how to play our instruments, dreaming of being in a band, let alone being a successful band, to end up in America at the Universal Amphitheater in LA, and they knock on the door and it was like incredible. So we became friends. We've gotten to play music together over the years. I've got up and played with them, and, you know, not many people get to meet their heroes on that sort of level, but they're the sweetest, nicest guys. So thankfully.
Awesome. You actually, you didn't just visit America. You and your wife and your two girls lived in America for nearly 10 years.
Yeah. We only came back in 2020.
Due to the pandemic?
Yeah. We moved over there in 2011. Just thought it was time to come back. It was just getting too weird over there. But yeah, I loved it. I absolutely called it home, and I didn't want to come back at first, but it was, we made the choice for our kids and, you know, for the health side of things. But yeah, I love it over there. It was great because I could, you know, we were living right in Hollywood. I could come here and play shows and stuff, and then I'd go home over there and sort of, you know, you're rubbing shoulders with, you know, talking about meeting your heroes and stuff. Some of the shows that I played over there with, you know, the guys in Guns N' Roses and Stray Cats and Chris from the Foo Fighters, and, you know, we did all these, had this sort of band that was put together with a whole lot of different people from different groups. And that was a bit of a pinch yourself moment, you know, doing those shows. So it's a fun place, but, you know, Australia's
the best. Are you back in Australia forever now?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
this is home. This is home. That was just a fun
time.
A lot of fun.
Your two girls, are they musical?
Yeah, my youngest daughter, who's 15, is a really good singer, and she plays a bit of piano, starting to write her own songs. My eldest one, not so much. She loves music, but she doesn't play. But yeah, my youngest one is, she's got an amazing voice, just one of those sort of naturals, you know, it's not sort of forced. She just has really good pitch and much better than I was at that age.
Beautiful. So she might carry on the family tradition of music.
I think so. She's on her way.
God bless her.
You are listening to Still Rocking It, the podcast with Cheryl Lee.
Chris talks about working with Jimmy Barnes. He featured in this song, Lay Down Your Guns, from Barnes's 30-30 Hindsight album in 2014. Let's have a listen, and back to speak to Chris after this. It's the 25th anniversary of the album, and my goodness, there's some killer songs on here. I think you wrote most of them. When did you realise you had a talent for writing such fabulous songs?
Well, that was the next step in our journey, really, for Scott and I. Was first thing was we had to learn how to play and just learn how to put chords together, and then play as a group. You know, getting a drummer and then trying to count off a song and play tight. You know, these are all like really important steps in getting a band together. And it seems so easy now, you know, just playing a song together. But it wasn't back then. You know, you have to sort of figure out how to play together as a unit and the dynamics. And so we were a cover band for, I don't know, 4 or 5 years or something, really, where we only played covers. We had dabbled a little bit in writing our own songs, but the songs were awful. It wasn't until 95, end of 95, I think we put our first EP out, which was all original songs. But yeah, I don't know. I feel like it's just been a work in progress. For me, I think, as I said earlier, it's been really beneficial being into different styles of music and trying to bring them into what we do. That makes it harder in a way as well, because I'm always, you know, I love people like Paul Kelly, but I also love the Electric Light Orchestra, and I also love Radiohead, and I also love Stevie Ray Vaughan and The Clash. How do you meld all those things together? I mean, I don't think you can. So for me, it's always been trying to pull things from here and there that I like, but have it sound like what The Living End does. I don't know. It's like trying to find the pieces of a puzzle and fit them together. And luckily enough, with that first record, I feel like we invented a whole lot of things that, you know, there wasn't a band that existed like us at that point that we had. So I was trying to invent that band. So songs like Second Solution and West End Riot and Prisoner and All Torn, they have these kind of, have a feel to them that was the kind of band that we wanted to try and find when we were starting out.
Clearly, you hit on a perfect combination, because not only did it reach number one on the ARIA charts, but it remained in the top 50 for 63 weeks. So congratulations. Well done. For a debut album, amazing.
It was. It was amazing. Because, you know, when we first started, it's like we used to go around and play all the battle of the bands at the other high schools. And like I was saying earlier, we were the fish out of water, because everyone else was either playing like Australian Crawl songs or Chisel or Metallica or Nirvana, like top 40 stuff. And we would get up and play Johnny Be Good or Stray Cat Strut or whatever. And, you know, you could sort of see people going, well, you know, you guys have got potential, but, you know, it's never going to become like popular mainstream sort of stuff, because it was always very alternative. So it was an incredible thing when the album came out and went to number one, but then we had so many hit songs off it and we became this huge band. It wasn't like, oh, we started to do okay. It went the other direction. It was like one extreme to the other and just went through the roof.
Gangbusters.
Yeah, but that's what often happens. If you've got something that is not popular and is not what everyone wants to hear, if that thing becomes popular, then it just spreads like wildfire. You know, we stood out from every other band at that point. You know, everyone knew who The Living End was because of the double bass, because of the kind of guitars I played, the three-piece, the energy, the guitar solos, the anthemic kind of. We had all these different things that we didn't even think about. It was just what we were doing. And then when it became popular, it became really popular.
Still Rocking It podcast with that radio chick, Cheryl Lee. While we're on a bit of a roll, let's have another one from The Living End and Barnsey. They did a great version of the Resurrection Shuffle on Jimmy's Double Happiness album in 2005. Back to speak to The Living End's Chris Cheney straight after this.
I put your hand on your hip, then you let your backbone slip.
Congratulations. There's a 25th anniversary, a limited edition of that album out now. I was just trying to have a look. Is it a coloured vinyl?
Yeah, it's a coloured vinyl. Took quite a few months to put that thing together. We didn't know whether we were going to do anything special for the 25th or not. You know, we've never been a big fan of sort of looking back too much. You know, we've felt like we've moved forward. We've always looked towards the next project. So we thought, if we're going to do something, let's do something special. So we did like the one show at Festival Hall, where we basically got up and played that record from start to finish. And that that vinyl, yeah, came with an extra disc of a Live at the Wireless thing and a 30-page booklet with just some old rare photos. And yeah, it turned out really good.
You can get that if you click on the link on the Living End website. We love vinyl. I don't know. It must be a nostalgia thing. And, you know, if you make it coloured, even better.
Yeah. It's a great medium, because I think people, with everything being so digital and so disposable these days, you know, it's nice to have that sort of piece of artwork to actually hold and have a look at and flick through it and
hear the scratches at the beginning when you put that needle on. It transports you, I reckon. It's like a time machine.
Yeah, absolutely.
If you get to listen to whatever you want in your car or whatever, what do you like to listen to at the moment?
I'm always probably going back to like singer-songwriters, songs. That's what I like to listen to. I'm not really into sounds as such. You know, I've never been a big fan of bands who focus on sonic quality as opposed to the songs that, like, I would listen to Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers or Ryan Adams or Beatles. I never get tired of those sort of hooks in songs. That's what I love about music.
Have you got a favourite song of the moment? Got one?
I don't really have a favourite song of the moment. Play a Tom Petty song. Yeah, I mean, his stuff never gets old.
You are listening to Still Rocking It, the podcast with Cheryl Lee.
Chris's wish is my command. Here is now Tom Petty from his Full Moon Fever album from 1989, Free Falling. Then back to finish up our Zoom room chat with Chris Cheney after this. I'm going to see you in Monday very soon, you guys.
Yep.
Have you played that before?
We have not. We've played the Big Red Bash, which I guess is the sister festival of that, which was amazing. That was one of the best gigs ever. So I know this is a different location, but I think it's going to be equally as beautiful, and I think it's going to be amazing. I've heard such great things about it, and we just haven't been playing that many shows recently. So whenever we do, we make it count, you know. So it's really going to be something.
I'm very excited. We weren't going because we had a huge holiday in Europe and the UK earlier in the year, so we had to pull our heads in. And then just the other day, we just decided, bugger it, let's do it. So I'll see you down the front. Monday right. With my Tina Turner outfit on and the blue outfit for Beyond Blue and the Madison World Record attempt. It's going to be awesome.
Such a great festival.
Yes. Have you got 1 second? I just want to show you something.
Sure.
Very quickly. Quick insert into the podcast. I'm just showing Chris my Barnstormers vinyl.
Ah, there we go.
And I've got the T-shirt as well.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, that was a fun one to make.
Are you guys going to do anything else together?
Well, I hope so. We've actually started recording some more songs for it. I don't know when we're going to put that out, but everyone's really invested. The biggest problem is that we're just so spread out. That's why we can't make it work.
Well, you heard it first here, so stay tuned.
That record turned out better than any of us could have hoped, I think. You know, I think we were all really surprised because we always wanted to do that album. Jimmy and I had spoken about it for years. He'd been talking about it with Slim Jim for years. You know, Kevin Shirley, who produced it and just produced our new record, he kind of, you know, he had the contact with Jules Holland, so he brought him in. And every track that was coming back, you know, after it was mixed, we'd be like, man, this is sounding really, really good. And it was important for us because being fans of that style of music, you don't want to stuff it up. You know, it can't sound like a Kmart version of rockabilly. It had to sound authentic and had to really kick where it needed to. And yeah, I'm really happy with it.
Because being obviously an Adelaide girl, you have to be a Cold Chisel fan and you have to be a Jimmy fan. So win, 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 win. Yeah, it's a great album. And I look forward to hearing some more music from the Barnstormers.
Yeah. Well, fingers crossed we get up on stage at some point too. So that is the plan. It's just a matter of trying to figure out the right vehicle to do it. It has to be like a festival or something in order for them. We do some shows around that, I suppose.
Awesome.
Still Rocking It podcast with that radio chick, Cheryl Lee.
Quick song from that wonderful Barnstormers album now, Johnny's Gone. It was written by Don Walker. And then we're back to say goodbye to the Living End's Chris Cheney.
Headlights, Johnny's gone. Street between headlights, Johnny's gone. Johnny's gone, gone.
Was there anything else, Chris, that you wanted to mention?
We covered Monday. That's the most important thing at this point. Is really looking forward to playing it, and looks amazing.
It's going to be an extraordinary experience. So I'm a Monday virgin as well as you. So we won't be for long. I'll see you there in a few weeks.
Yeah, awesome.
Thank you so much for your time today, Chris. I know you're a busy man. We really appreciate having the opportunity to chat with you today.
No worries. Thank you. Good to chat.
All right, I'll see you there.
All right, see ya. Bye.
You are listening to Still Rocking It, the podcast with Cheryl Lee.
We are going to go out with the 2009's APRA Music Awards Song of the Year and one of my favourite Living End songs of all time, White Noise. You're with Cheryl Lee, that radio chick. Thank you so much for joining me on the Still Rocking It podcast. Hope to catch you again next time. Get out when you can, support Aussie music, and I'll see you down the front.